Rivalry Week presented by Wendy's. We are in Big 12 country, Morgantown, West Virginia, on a bitterly cold, snowy night, 12 degrees outside. We welcome the Kansas Jayhawks, who lead the Big 12 by 2 games. And there is West Virginia in a bit of a slump right now, having lost 3 of their last 4, but they stand at 7-5. Good evening, everybody. With Grant Fraschilla, I'm Brent Musburger. Thanks for dropping by. I hope you're nice and warm wherever you are. Fran, you and I talked, and you told me this could be a bit of a trap game for the Jayhawks.
Oh, no question about it. On the road versus a ranked team that's going to play desperate tonight. And by the way, they play one of the most unique styles of defense of anybody in the country. They press from start to finish, so Kansas really has to be ready to handle that pressure early.
And we're joined by an all-star cast tonight, of course, Holly Rowe, who is always with us on our Big Mondays, part of the team. But we welcome Seth Greenberg, and he's had some special inside looks at West Virginia. Just emerged from the locker room. Seth, what's up with the Mountaineers?
I had a chance to listen in on Bob Huggins' pregame talk. First, Larry Harrison, he went over the matchups, and the key point for the Mountaineers, pressure on the ball, front the post, and give good backside help. Then Bobby Huggins addressed his team. It was all about making Kansas uncomfortable. Get underneath them. Make them react to our defense. And most importantly, do not respond to anything else but what you can control. Don't worry about the officials. Don't worry about how the game's being called. Be the hardest playing, toughest team. And now to Holly Rowe behind the Kansas bench.
Kansas coach Bill Self is concerned about their short prep time to prepare for seeing Virginia, West Virginia, for the first time, and that pressure. He only had 30 minutes of practice yesterday before they had to get on a plane and fly here to Morgantown. So 10 days ago, he prepared. He spent one whole practice having 8 guys play against his 5 guys on the floor. He wanted them to get used to the chaos, the tenacity. I talked to his point guard, Frank Mason, after practice today, and he said, you know, I love it when people press me. That means I get to use my speed. We'll see how much he loves it after things get rolling here in Morgantown.
All right, Holly, as we take a look at our starting lineups. For Kansas, the freshman, Cliff Alexander, joins Mason, Sullivan, Oubre, and Ellis. And on the West Virginia side, Brown, Miles, Holton, and Williams will join their leader, number 3, folks, Jawan Staten, one of the best guards in the Big 12. The officials tonight, and one of them's a little bit of a story. Doug Sermons, our lead man, working with Ray Natilli and Kip Kissinger. Doug Sermons called his 4th pregame technical, and that was before the TCU-Oklahoma State game. And Doug, right here, ready to walk out, started that game with TCU hitting 2 free throws. I said, is that unusual? He said, it's the 4th time I've had it this year.
Wow, how about that?
You cannot dunk during pregame warm-up, because if they break the glass backboard in the college game, it would take too long to replace it.
Bad enough we have those replay reviews, right? So all we need is for the rim to come down before the game starts.
Settle in, folks. Here we go, Morgantown.
Man-to-man by Kansas almost always. West Virginia needs really good ball movement tonight.
Williams had a big game in that win over the Jayhawks last season. This is Brown, veteran Puerto Rico, kicking into the corner. Takes the game's first shot and nails the 3-ball. That's a huge start.
That allows them, Brent, to set up this pressure. Key word for Kansas tonight, anticipation. The traps are coming. They've got to be ready to handle them.
Selden calmly across the timeline. They're left with 25 on the shot clock when they come to the attack. They trap Selden. Perry Ellis over the top. Down come the Mountaineers, looking to put together baskets at the start. Here's Staten. He's cut off.
run what we call a five-man motion. So you want to see five white jerseys all in action.
Staten's open. Misses the J. Battle for the rebound into Seldon's hands. And here comes Mason. Mason, the captain of this offense. Inside again to Ellis. Second shot of the game. 0 for 2.
It's a really good start for West Virginia. They forced Perry Ellis into two quick shots.
Knocked away from Brown. West Virginia basketball, 21 on the shot.
The whole key for West Virginia in the half court, Brent, is they've got to make shots. They're one of the worst shooting teams in the country from the perimeter. They get a lot of their offense off their defense.
Struggling in the half court. Five on the shot. Stripped away. And out of bounds. 4 seconds on that shot clock. West Virginia will have to set it on the inbounds pass.
Watch Brown, number 14.
He curls. And he draws the game's first foul. Kelly Oubre, the 6'7" freshman from New Orleans, got him.
We watched this today at the shoot-around. They put this little play in, little rub screen, and then he gets Oubre in the air, Brown, the senior. Very savvy move for the young man from San Juan, Puerto Rico.
He's 6'1", senior. And you talked about shooting. They do not shoot free throws well either.
No, they certainly don't. And that's what's made this 19-5 or 6 run so impressive, Brent, because they're doing it on the heels of great defense.
They've left early points on the table, Fran, already. And when you're playing a talented Kansas Jayhawk team, you don't want to do that. Pressure is set up after the made free throw, and Oubre to help out. And here's Seldon off him. They turn it over. They get a break on the pressure. Staten's going to roll. Out of bounds.
That time, Seldon just kicked the basketball in the open court. Again, this is random. There's no rhyme or reason for when they double.
But one thing to keep in mind, West Virginia did not convert, but they do off the inbounds pass. That's the big fella. Went for 22 last year in that win. And so now they build a 6-0 lead. The ball. Ellis, remember, has it knocked away. They've turned it over on back-to-back possessions. Back-to-back empties and a turnover. Let's see if the Mountaineers can take advantage again. Staten on the dribble is cut off. Williams on the pick and roll wants it. Ellis switches over on him. They get back outside. But an offensive rebound. Holton gets it inside to Miles, and he scores. Timeout. Self is unhappy. Bill Self sent Landon Lucas onto the floor. Holly, what was the Jayhawk huddle like?
Well, Bill Self is pretty disgusted right now with the start that his team got out to. Cliff Alexander, a quick hook on the bench after just starting his fourth game of the season. As Landon Lucas took the floor, Bill Self grabbed him, shook him by the shoulders, like, go out there and be a big man.
And it is Oubre off the timeout who puts the Jayhawks on the board. One of the more talented freshmen in the country.
Once you break that press, Brent, you've got to attack. They're not good in the quarter court near the basket.
Holton has contributed one offensive rebound. Yeah. They don't even need one. Williams steps out and nets it. It's an 8-point advantage. Fran, you called it. Look at this press again. Only one day to get ready, and the Jayhawks show it. Into the corner, Seldon thought about it, and he stepped out of bounds. That's the third Jayhawk turnover against the pressure. And that will signal the arrival of Devontae Graham.
Bill Self told me about a week ago, in talking about West Virginia, they're very fortunate to have Devontae Graham healthy after missing six games in December and January. For this reason, the West Virginia pressure.
I believe a year ago, West Virginia mounted a big lead, and then the Jayhawks rallied. Wiggins in that game scored 41, if my memory is correct.
You are correct.
And now the Mountaineers have come to it. And we've got a timeout. 10-2, West Virginia.
Will, Juwan.
I'm Juwan Staten, and the best thing about a good press is you never know when it's coming.
You never know when the pressure's coming.
You never know where the press is coming.
Ten-2 lead for West Virginia. Yes, the press is coming, and it's made its effect felt early. Now it's a random full-court press. Holton's on the ball. He's going to leave the ball and try to trap, and they throw it back to Seldon, who inexplicably doesn't catch it with two hands. And now he kicks it ahead, and that leads to the turnover. Hey, Seth, what are you seeing there?
Well, watching practice yesterday, Bob Huggins said they're going to trap all perimeter players, including Oubre, and forcing the ball out of her hands. They really wanted to trap Oubre because they thought he was not a good passer and struggled in pressure. And if they could force Ellis and Alexander to handle basketball, they thought they could turn him over, which would create some easy offense for him.
And indeed, it has been easy offense here, Seth. And Fran, 10-2, Mountaineers. Slim underdog here tonight by Hoop, and this pressure defense creating turmoil right now. They force another turnover, and Coach Huggins has gone to his bench. He substituted three guys already, missing a three, and the rebound is cleaned by the Jayhawks. Lucas on the floor. Let's see if Mason can do it off penetration, and he does. That's why he's so valuable for the Jayhawks.
There's another example, Brent. If you break the press, there's a lot of room to be able to get to the rim.
Carter has checked in. Phillip has checked in. Staten stays on the floor. Connor had three bombs. Adrian is also out. Loose, one on the shot, has the fire of desperation. Good D, but they get it right back.
And that keeps Kansas on defense another 35 seconds. West Virginia so far has done a good job of taking care of the basketball in the half court.
Carter puts it on the deck, kicks back outside to an open jump shot, not there. Ellis cleans it out for the Jayhawks. Foul is going to go against the Mountaineers. A little bit too much pressure, that's not right.
Well, no question, and that's been their M.O. They are third in the nation in fouls committed. About 25 fouls a game. But because they have so much depth, Brent, and they're so committed to this style, it works for them.
Huggins does not want Williams on the bench long. He's back on the floor. Back down by Traylor, who is out there. This is Oubre. Oubre looking for his shot any way he can get it. Long ball up over the top. Mountaineer basketball with a six-point lead here. And that was Green. Let me check that. That's about the second time I have misidentified him.
Well, when Brandon Green shoots it quickly like he does, you know it's him. He has the green light for Bill Self.
Carter off the dribble, and he drew the foul. That's
the second time so far in this game that they have got those Kansas bigs up in the air. I really love this kid, Javon Carter, Brent, out of Proviso East High School, a school you know well.
Extremely well. A lot of good players that come out.
Absolutely. Doc Rivers, Michael Finley, D. Brown, Shannon Brown.
Suburb of Chicago.
You and I remember the great Jim Brewer, who played on the 1972 Olympic team.
Jimmy went to Minnesota.
Yep. Same high school.
Brown has come back on the floor for the Mountaineers. Mason trying to dribble through two, and he does. Now they got a manpower advantage. Leave him back open, and he misfires the three, tracked down by the Mountaineers.
Good
and they give it right back, and it is Mason all over the floor. Mason attacks left hand.
Landon Lucas, a terrific back tip.
That will bring Staten right back into this game. Mason's performance while he's been over there on the bench has been a huge difference here. Williams turns right, short, and Holton yanks it down. Another offensive rebound, and Brown misfires, and there's Williams. Two offensive rebounds. Phillip off the dribble. Rap, no. Tracked down again by the Mountaineers as they keep possession of the ball.
This is how they shoot 16 more field goal attempts than their opponents. Great offensive rebounding team. A really good young two-way guard. Excellent on defense as well.
A foul's going to be called on Selden. Phillip picked his pocket. Selden reached back. And guess who's checking in? The Ukrainian who had heavy time in practice today, Mykhailuk. The 6'8 freshman from the Ukraine. And the reason why he's out there, folks, obviously he's got good hands. When you work against the press of the big man, what you look for is someone who can catch and pass, Fran.
Absolutely, and he's been buried on that bench for a while now, but they certainly need some savvy from that backcourt.
In the shoot-around today, he was very active. Attack no good. And they steal another one underneath the hoop. Adrian gives it up, and here is Staten back on the floor.
Yeah, I would certainly use clock right now. A lot of movement.
Staten against Graham. The three, no, but another offensive rebound. Fran, they're just killing them on the offensive glass. That's 8 offensive rebounds to none for the Jayhawks.
Big reason why is they miss a lot of shots, but they're relentless on the glass.
There's a timeout on the court.
We're going to take a break here as the ball slips out of bounds. It's 14-6 West Virginia. West Virginia 14, Kansas 6, 11:29 to go here in the first half as Bob Huggins' crew with this pressure defense. You can see the 4 NCAA categories that they lead in. Steals, offensive rebounds, turnover margin, and turnovers forced. And the turnover percentage also leads the NCAA. And they are off to a great start here tonight under Coach Huggins' leadership. You can see him out there. He pulls the bench away. He talks to his players, and just as soon now as they break the huddle, Huggins is going to head back toward our man Seth Greenberg, who has been spending a lot of time with Huggins in West Virginia. So, Seth, here comes Huggy Bear. Let's go to you now.
Huggs, good to see you. The start of this game, is this what you expected from your team bouncing back?
Well, I knew we were going to play with great emotion. Fortunately, we had some shots go in.
What kind of adjustments can you make coming forward against this press offense?
We're going to make some adjustments to the press. I didn't know what they were going to do because they haven't been pressed like this.
Good luck.
They get the ball down the floor. the Jayhawks. And one and done. Williams sealed up beautifully for that defensive rebound.
I'll tell you, I love Devin Williams, a sophomore. He is going to be an outstanding Big 12 player.
Steal. It's that young man again, Devontae Graham, the freshman from Raleigh. Here's Ellis coming baseline. The cleanup is Traylor. They finally get an offensive putback, Frank.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm telling you, Brent, if you handle the pressure for about 70 feet, once you get 30 feet and in, you can score on this West Virginia defense.
Page with the three ball. A 6'2 junior from Jamestown, New York.
Best outside shooter. And remember, not only the points, but it allows them to set up the pressure.
Terrific pass by the Ukrainian that time. And offensive foul is called on Graham.
When you beat the press, you're in such a hurry to get to the basket because you've got some breathing room, but that time the freshman a little bit out of control.
That's the sixth Jayhawk turnover. A frustrated self looking on. You can see the second chance points in this game.
And Kansas only has three defensive rebounds.
Carter. Weaving inside again.
Staten.
Self has got to have a timeout, Frank.
No reason to save him. Not right now, anyway.
Well, tomorrow, ESPN Super Tuesday and Rivalry Week continues. SEC, Kentucky still unbeaten, taking on Tennessee, then at 9, Michigan State, and Michigan, Fran, take me to Kentucky.
They're running out of places where they can lose, Brent. They've answered every call down the stretch in the SEC. Tennessee is awaiting for Big Blue tomorrow night.
Hey, Seth, let's bring Seth in on this conversation about Kentucky. Seth, your feeling is that Fran thinks they're running out of opponents that can handle them. Your thoughts?
I think they're going to run the table. Is Kansas team right now, because they're struggling offensively, as it's had in their other losses, it's really affecting them defensively. They are not locked in defensively. When they get stuck offensively, defensively, they lose the focus.
Bill Self, Fran, very unhappy down here.
Yeah, well, I think he's more unhappy first with his team. Now, the one thing about this foul right here is, oh, he can't run the baseline.
He just did.
Well, unless maybe there wasn't a foul call.
A blocking foul against the Mountaineers. Staten. So Staten picks up his first. There's a whole lot of folks helping these officials here today.
Yeah, no question about it. And you mentioned the crowd would be much larger, Brent, if it weren't for the weather. Awful weather outside. Look at that pass.
Keeping Seldon on the floor. Well, it counts.
Oh, yeah. No, Seldon's been really, really good last five games.
Exactly. You need his firepower was the point I was going to make.
Exactly.
Kissed one off the glass.
Kansas foul ball to number 31, Jamari Traylor, is first. Fifth team foul against Kansas.
Now, what I like so far from West Virginia, Brent, is they've taken care of the basketball.
Yeah. Here's Carter up on top, working with Staten. Williams loads in low, gets it back. Battle for the basketball.
3 second violation.
And the 3 second violation.
At that time, West Virginia got bunched up inside. Holton was trying to get rid of it. So was Williams, but they got to clear the lane.
That's their fifth turnover, by the way. They lead it by 9. Selden gets in the trailer, and there's a foul called against the Mountaineers. And that's on Williams.
What you have to do, Brent, if you're Kansas, is anticipate that traps are coming. And then once there's a trap, a good press offense has 3 outlets and a long at the basket.
Here's Oubre now handling the ball. Gives it to Mason. Beautiful feed to Traylor. Offensive rebound put back, and Ellis was fouled. Slowly, ever so slowly, the Jayhawks are starting to tighten the screws.
Yeah, I agree. Look, they got to get used to this. You see, watch Perry Ellis. He's going to get fouled, but Brent, you're absolutely right. After 12 minutes, you would think Kansas would start to adjust to the frenetic great pace.
Huggins and the Mountaineers want an ugly game, and that's what we've had so far. And it's the Jayhawks who are going to have to adjust here as Ellis gets on the scoreboard with free throws, his first points of the night.
Now, when you play West Virginia, you're not going to get a Picasso. It's going to be more like graffiti.
Staten pulls it up and knocks down a 2. And Seth, what about trying to adjust to this defense?
You know, I look at this defense like playing against a triple option in football. It takes time to settle in and get a feel for the speed and how people are going to attack you. And I think Kansas will eventually adjust to it. It depends on can they adjust in time to get back in this game. That's going to be the big question.
Yeah, they've adjusted already a little bit. Oubre with that shot. And now that Mountaineers miss from the 3 and Selden out beautifully. Here's Oubre again and with emphasis. There's no question. They have changed and they have tightened it up.
Yep, and if they can get those kind of baskets off of their defense, certainly makes things even easier for them.
Alexander's back on the floor for the Jayhawks. Staten against Mason. Wonderful guard duel here in the Big 12 tonight at Morgantown. This is Carter against Selden.
See, I don't like to see this much standing around from West Virginia.
As you pointed out, not a great outside shooting team. Miles off the dribble. Oubre cuts him off. Double, leaves an open man. Macon draws a foul. He's coming to the free throw line. He's a 6'9 redshirt freshman. As we take a break, and one of the ringleaders, this team settles in, and Bill Self gave him a few minutes to take a look at it, is Kelly Oubre, the young man from New Orleans. He is making a difference now. As we've got a timeout, 21-16. That friend, that was nasty.
Yeah, not knowing the context, you're going to see a multi-game suspension because there's no place for that. That was
ugly.
It sure was. Of course, Villanova won easily, by the way, 80-54.
That's a team that also challenging for a possible number 1 seed. Just like the Jayhawks. Right now, I think Joey Brackets has got them both too, but they're in the discussion.
I agree.
Macon rattles out, and at that free throw line, they are 3 of 5, the Mountaineers. Jayhawks have hit both their free throws. The Jayhawks, folks, even press and all, they're hitting 50% from the field. They're hitting 7 of 14. So, let's not say that this is a totally dismal performance. Yes, they have turned it over 6 times. And those 6 turnovers have led to 6 points. That's all.
Yep.
Okay?
And West Virginia, to your point, allows you to score in the half court as long as you take care of the ball in the full court.
the drive, and a blocking foul. Macon was the man down on the lower block. And he's assessed the personal foul.
And Evan Williams checks back into the mound here.
Speaking of our man, Mr. Lenardi, he's got seven in right now. Now, this is why it's a troubling time for the Mountaineers of West Virginia, okay? They've got to put something on their resume down the stretch. Don't necessarily have to win this game here tonight against the Jayhawks, but they have lost three of their last four, and they're in danger. They're in grave danger.
I would say the flip side of that is they've got the opportunity to win some quality games, because every team left on their schedule is in the BPI top 35. So exactly right, Brent. They've got to get some wins going, but the opportunities to impress the committee are certainly abounding.
Williams out high. Puts it on the deck and drives in for layup. Oh, he's one of the stronger guys in the conference.
Oh, no question. And he's going up against a pretty physical guy in the freshman Alexander. To your point, West Virginia's got to keep scoring, because that allows him to set that press up.
It's now Selden. Good drive. Wouldn't stay down. Offensive putback by Traylor. That's twice now the Traylor has cleaned up underneath. He has made a difference coming off the bench.
Yep, and that comes at an opportune time, because Jamari Traylor has not played well lately. Only 31 minutes last two. No field goals.
Williams working that baseline. Staten's three. Yes!
Sounds simple, but that's important, because West Virginia will have some scoring droughts.
5.5 minutes. Selden drives and scores.
Selden. I'm going to ask you a question, Brent. Last couple possessions, looks like a turnover. Have you seen any full court pressure from West Virginia?
They haven't bothered the Jayhawks a lick in the last couple of possessions. It just took them a little time to get used to it. And, you know, Holly at the top of the broadcast, she made the biggest point of all. They only have one day to get ready. And that's not easy.
Not easy at all.
You know, it's like when you play Georgia Tech.
Yes.
And Seth alluded to that offense. Florida State had 1 week to get ready for them. They had trouble with it.
I agree.
It was very difficult. Lucas, bad pass.
And Bill Self told us today, these big men do not pass the ball the way they have in the past.
From the corner, the three, not there. Battle for the rebound. Snapped away beautifully by Carter. Open, Staten, no. Battle again, and this time into Oubre's hands. Now they attack on the move. Traylor didn't stay down, and batted away beautifully by Holton. There's a young man they've been waiting to grow up here all season long. That was a big-time block by number one.
And the best thing about this is Holton is staying on the floor, because he's not picking up cheap fouls. Great energy right there.
Williams will take a seat, and Brannon Green, the 6'7 sophomore from Georgia, number 14, will replace Selden. Mason takes it out. Oubre trapped. Plenty of time here for the Jayhawks. Mason can't get the whistle, but in underneath.
Oh, man.
And putting it down is Lucas.
Lucas.
Right man, right place.
He was. Looked like a little bit of a shove from here, but hey, he got away with it. And Lucas has played very well for Bill Self down the stretch of the season.
The lead is down to two. 4 minutes remain in the first half. This is Holton. Carter. Off the iron. Lucas goes to track it down, and saved by West Virginia. That's good play by Holton. So we've got a break here at the 3:53 mark. 26-24, Mountaineers. Thank you very much. At 26-24, the Jayhawks have closed back in. Keep in mind, if you just joined us, Kansas trailed by 11 in this game. And Holly, what's Self's message now to the Jayhawks?
Well, he had one positive thing to say. He said, guys, you played like you know what, we're only down two. But he wants them to drive the basketball and be stronger with the ball. He said, I trust Frank Mason to make every play. So look for them to go more to Mason and have the ball in his hands.
Friend?
No, I think it's a great point. Right now, we just saw them turn it over, West Virginia. I do think your point is excellent, Brent. It took a while for the speed of that defense for Kansas to take a look at it, and now they've been much better. Here they come again.
Oubre runs the floor, cleaned out by Holton. Come the Jayhawks now with a chance to tie it or take the lead. Mason against Page, and he's on the free throw line. He'll shoot for the tie.
Well, take a look, Brent. This is what Seth has pointed out. Missed shot, Kansas cleans up the rebound, and then because West Virginia crashes so hard, they allow these kind of runouts. Seth, what are you thinking there?
I think Kansas is doing a much better job of clearing early. They're getting stops on the defense, and then they're rebounding the ball. Instead of bringing people back, they're running out, throwing over the top. And then even on made shots, instead of bringing people back to the ball, they're telling Frank Mason, take that thing and attack. Make plays at the rim. Don't react to them, but make them react to you.
Seven fouls on West Virginia and six on the Jayhawks.
Brent, when you sell out to the offensive rebound like West Virginia does, and they've already got 10 today, it allows your opponent to get out and get those easy baskets in transition.
Phillip back on the floor for the Mountaineers. Phillip loads Williams on the right baseline. And Staten. And Graham stuck with him, and he pulls up the J and misses. A good defense by Graham. They did not let him get to the rim.
Yep, but this Carter's everywhere.
Yeah, he's very active.
Yep. He really is.
Good future. And it's the muscle William.
How he found out today, 7% body fat on this guy, and he goes about 255.
Jayhawks turn it over.
It's imperative, Brent, that West Virginia goes to the locker room with the lead. I mentioned at the very beginning, the psychological advantage is in their favor because they have to play desperately, but they don't want to give away that 11-point lead so easily.
Carter with a slick pass.
Boy, Adrian cannot buy a basket this whole season.
Of course, another Jayhawk turnover. But can they convert? Points off these turnovers. They just have not been that productive off of them.
That's a great point. Only six to this point.
Carter, yes, that one is productive. Nails a three ball.
Most of the country's never heard of this kid. He's averaging about 8-9 points a game, and he's as good defensively. I think he got that last steal.
That's 7 points for him tonight already, Fran.
Oh, yeah, he's going to be charged with harassment here soon.
Miscount by the crowd. They get it in down low, and Terry Ellis scores it. Last minute now.
Yep.
At the other end, there's your man Carter, and Ellis cleans up the miss. This could be a big run here for the Jayhawks late. Mason's three, yes. A one-point game.
And they tried to go 2-for-1, which Bill Self loves to do. They may get another possession out of that.
And Huggins wants a timeout, and he's barking. Look out now. Huggy's got to be careful.
Brent Mason threw it out of the trap, which was the whole key. Ellis scores. But I want you to watch this last basket, Brent. Watch this shot clock. They're in tune with the 2-for-1 play, which means if he shoots it at around 45, 44, they may have a second opportunity to get another possession. That's what we call 2-for-1 right there.
Once down 11. The Jayhawks have whittled away at this lead. 28, as you can see on the shot clock, as they're offset by 5.5 seconds right now.
Tyus Jones playing great basketball for Mike Krzyzewski, outstanding point guard.
Staten. Yes!
He's been to three. Yep, and I love his aggressiveness today.
Off the front of the iron, but it's Ellis on a putback and the buzzer not there. That last tip did not count.
Halftime score,
it's a 3-point lead. West Virginia leading Kansas at the intermission. And let's go to Holly Rowe with Coach Bill Self.
Well, Coach, what would you say were the positives and negatives of that first time seeing that pressure against West Virginia?
Well, the positive was is we came back a little bit. The negative was we played awful, and they made us play awful. You know, we actually handled their backcourt pressure fairly well. What we did a poor job of once we got in the forecourt, and then we didn't score around the basket enough, and they kicked our butt on the glass, and our guards have got to rebound, and we did a terrible job of that.
What do you do to rebound better, especially offensive rebounds? They were up 8-0 at one point.
Well, it's not the zero I'm worried about. It's the eight. So if we get more aggressive and our best players play like they're capable of playing and get aggressive, I think we can balance it out.
Thanks, Coach.
Thanks.
Thanks, Holly. And so at halftime, it's a 3-point lead for West Virginia as we go to Adnan Burke and Jay Williams with the Mazda halftime report. The Kansas Jayhawks trail West Virginia by 3 at the intermission, 33-30. But Frank Fraschilla, they were down by 11 at one point early in this basketball game.
Yeah, I thought they really did a good job of adjusting to the speed and the intensity of the press. The other thing they've done is West Virginia really hasn't capitalized on the 11 offensive rebounds that they've got against this Kansas defense. It's allowed Kansas to get out in transition and run and get easy baskets without having to deal with the press. Take a look now. If you rebound the ball against this team, you have a chance to run out on them because they sell out by sending 4, sometimes 5 to the glass. Another example here. Grab the rebound, don't turn it over, and now get up the floor. And this is a big shot at the end of the half by Frank Mason Jr.
And Seth Greenberg, what did you see over there behind the West Virginia bench?
Early in the first half, I thought West Virginia did a great job of back-trapping the guards, getting it out of their hands, forcing non-ball handles to handle the ball, and did a great job of chasing from behind and creating turnovers. And then on made baskets, they forced the ball dead to the corner, against smaller guards, turned Devontae Gardner over right there, Devontae Graham over right there for an easy scoring opportunity. Adjustment. Kansas did a good job of clearing the offense out and had Frank Mason attack off the bounce in the open floor. Look for West Virginia to backtrack Frank Mason early in the possession.
One of the big substitutions in this game is Jamari Traylor, who came off the Jayhawks bench. He had 2 field goals, and he had 2 offensive rebounds. He was the most effective of their big men. He opens as Ellis attacks. Traylor is out now to start the second half for the Jayhawks.
Great execution right out of the timeout. Perry Ellis had the back door cut, wasn't there. He took it himself.
Williams muscles in. When I say muscles in, I mean it. He missed the shot, and Ellis cleaned it out. The Jayhawks have never led, looking for their first lead. Oubre for it, got it. Kansas ahead for the first time.
That's so big, Brent. Kelly Oubre shoots 14% from three on the road. Of course, that was earlier in the year.
Now it's Huggins' turn to be upset. Jayhawks have outscored West Virginia 5-0 to open the second half. Holly, they look rather fresh for just one day between games.
Well, that's right. Their strength and conditioning coach gives them this bag. It's called a recovery bag. Inside, all kinds of goodies, little things to pick up with their toes to get their joints more mobile, increase circulation, things to roll out their sore muscles. They've got a sleep mask, a neck pillow, and the number one thing, guys, this vibrating foam roller, you roll this up and down your legs. I'm telling you, you're going to want one of these on the road with you.
I'm going to try to find one of those, Brent. They're pretty good.
Miles has it knocked away and out of bounds. Mountaineer basketball here at the 19th. Andrea Hootie does an outstanding job with strength and conditioning. And the one thing Bill Self told us before practice today is we don't concentrate that much on muscle building as we do keeping players on the floor, not having them get injured. And that, she said, or he said about her, is really why she's so successful.
She's tremendous. She came from UConn, where they won men's and women's championships there.
Got the Miles in on the inside.
Paige had a layup first. He was spooked by the shot blocker. Should have went right up.
Now here's Traylor. Traylor has made a big difference in this game. Remember, he did not start. Alexander did. Alexander over on a bench watching. The veteran, a little bit more confident against this harassing pressure defense. Here's Traylor again. Knows he's got time on the shot clock. Kicks it back over to Oubre. Goes to set a screen. He's open on the pick and roll. From the corner, it's Traylor. Now he's got Ellis. Ellis spins inside. Folks, it's not the X's and O's. It's the Jimmy and Joes. And Traylor made a huge difference.
Say, Jamari Traylor threw a no-look pass. I've seen him do that recently, Brent. He's got a really good IQ for a guy who's supposed to be a lumberjack.
Feed in low. Here's Holton. Short with that hook shot. Cleaned up by you-know-who. Number 3-1 is my MVP in this comeback. Kick to the open, Ellis. Yep. Ellis fires it. Yes, sir.
That's what he does.
Main man at the match is Traylor.
I've seen him do that. You know, he redshirted with Ben McLemore the year they went to the Final Four. And he's become a terrific role player.
Staten hits a huge three for the Mountaineers. Pulls them back to within four.
We haven't seen the energy from West Virginia at the end of the first half, early second.
Sylvan has to pick it up, and now it'll be Mason who'll come across the timeline. Went behind his back. Dangerous. Goes to the floor to pick it up. Battle for the loose ball.
Got a personal foul.
Foul's going to be called.
They got Ellis, Brent.
Kansas ball, called at number 34.
I'll tell you, our guy Carter made the deflection. Watch Carter now. And on this scrum, the rule is you just can't dive on the guy, and they call the foul on Ellis.
Good ball. He went over the top a little bit. He was very aggressive. He tried to get the basketball. We got to give Ellis marks for that, but he certainly did foul the ball. 4-point game now. Here come the Mountaineers. Huggins just had a couple of long-range gunners like Harris a year ago who helped light up the Jayhawks. Another foul is going to be called, this one on Mason. Tried to push Staten a little bit, trying to get him off balance, and that's his first person.
It sounds simple, but West Virginia needs to make baskets so they can set that pressure up.
Oubre fronts the inbounds pass. Williams out for that high screen. Great shot take that time. And a hoop for Adrian. And there he is, the youngster from Morgantown. His first field goal of the game.
A little more juice from the Mountaineers.
Here's Traylor, right baseline, kicks back outside now. Mason, open look, three, yes.
You know who made that play? Jamari Traylor. They trapped the ball, threw it to Traylor, and he swung it to the weak side. He created a lot of space for his teammates.
He's a difference maker here tonight, isn't he, friend? Here's Williams, steps out now with the J. That'll rebound Oubre into Mason's hands. Ellis, lob, Traylor finishes, no basket. Offensive foul. We're going to take a break here. Offensive foul is the call. 43-38, Kansas. Of course, we've got key games. How about Arizona?
Yep.
UCLA. Yep. Playing very well right now.
If Utah can continue to win, that Arizona-Utah matchup could be an outstanding one a couple Saturdays from now.
Carter on the floor, pulls up with an early three. Gonna get the long rebound, though. Ian Staten, both in that backcourt. Carter was very active, good performance in the first half. Williams screams, Page rattles out, but a putback, no. And it's finally Oubre is fouled by Williams.
You gotta finish those, Brent. It's what we talked about. It's great that you offensive rebound. They do it as well as anybody in the country. But you have to finish around the rim. The energy's great. The execution, not so much.
Oubre will come up against Williams, bringing it up against that pressure. Here's Ellis. Williams on him, attacks over the top, won't stay down.
Good job by Williams. He walled off the lane from Ellis.
Out of bounds. Kansas basketball. There's our turnovers. 11 for the Jayhawks and 8 for the Mountaineers.
Jayhawks, Brent, average about 13. Bill Self asked his team last night at the meeting, how many would be a good number versus West Virginia? Guy said 7, 8, and he goes, no, 15 or 16 would be fine.
Mason off the dribble, attacks, gets in low now to Ellis. Good defense by the Mountaineers, no foul called underneath, they come right back. And now it's Staten on the attack. Great play. Makes it a three-point game.
He's got to be even more aggressive. Because he can create easy baskets.
Oubre's answer is the three ball.
I'll tell you, from November 15th to right now, there can't be very many guys who've improved as much as he has. And he was a top 10 player. He just didn't get it when it started.
Into the corner for Williams, and he responds with a three ball. Traylor kicks inside. Selden put back, no, and a foul is going to be called.
Another great look by Jamari Traylor, a young man from Chicago. Bill Self's always had good passing big men. Take a look, Brent. You talked about Traylor. Watch the simple pass right there. Nothing fancy.
Selden's at the line. He's 0 for 1.
Hey, Fran, the reason that Alexander's not playing, in my opinion, is he's just not a good enough passer right now. They need an extra ball handler on the floor against this pressure to make plays. A trailer, he's done a great job with it.
Yep, I think he's more experienced, Seth, against this kind of defense. You're exactly right.
Billy D. Williams, He hit that last field goal. Kicks it outside. And Page travels.
Now, if I'm Bob Huggins right here, I want to see high energy from my pressure defense.
Trails by three. 13 minutes left in regulation. They hound Graham, but they get it to Traylor. There's a second pass to the open man for the three. Yes. Another veteran play by Traylor.
Amazing, Brent. I mean, you look at this guy. He's a big guy. He's a power forward. He's not really skilled around the basket offensively, but that's high IQ basketball.
Miles back on the floor for Coach Huggins. Kicks it to Phillip. Off the dribble, attacks. Tries to wrap, and it's Mason cleaning it up underneath. Oubre spins. West Virginia saves it.
Staten's getting a rest. He's checking back in, so they need a playmaker right now.
Over the top. Dangerous pass. Turn it over. A couple of the officials confer, and it's going to be West Virginia basketball when we come back. That was Doug Sermons who came in, saw it differently, and correctly.
Kansas by six. The Verizon, did you see that? Tonight it's been Jamari Traylor in the second half. Hustle play right there. Good screen, comes back for that ball. Nice look to the corner. He's got three assists, Brent. He's been really active. I love this play. Double team the ball. He's going to be under control. And when he swings it to the weak side, it creates a long closeout. And Kansas ends up with an open look for Mason. And Jamari Traylor, the guy that you pointed out early in this half, has been a big key.
So it was Mountaineers basketball and an offensive foul with the right arm. They give it right back to the Jayhawks. And there's Traylor over on the sideline right now watching. So the big fella just picked up, Devin Williams just picked up his third personal foul. We got to keep an eye on that. Here's Lucas, and that's going to be offense.
I mean, that's an automatic anymore in the post. Big guy's got to know. Sometimes the acting job's pretty good, but can't lower your shoulder like that.
So you can see the difference this half with the long ball. Jayhawks have hit all five of their three-point attempts in this game.
It's no surprise. This is Bill Self's best three-point shooting team in 12 years.
Frank Mason's playing well tonight with 14 points. Kelly Oubre has 14. And Staten leading the way. It's just difficult for Huggins to find option number two with this Mountaineer team. Staten clearly is number one. Attacks, kicks out to the corner now. And clunk. Offensive foul, I should say defensive foul.
Option number two this season has been a steal and a layup. And they've gotten very few of those tonight. Only 11 points off turnovers. They average 22. Shot it so well last year, Brent.
Here's Staten Double kicks back Miles. No. And he comes away. Aiden does with that offensive rebound that time. Good hustle. Staten again. Swatted back out of bounds by Lucas. Mason comes back in.
Mason checks back into the Jayhawks. You
know, we were talking earlier today about, for all the All-Americans Bill Self has had, he's had guys like Brady Morningstar and Landon Lucas, Tyrell Reed, really good role players, Jamari Traylor.
Traylor's back on the floor, by the way, as you were mentioning. Catch and shoot, Carter not there, and digging out another one is Adrian. Big favorite here, this is his hometown, Morgantown. West Virginia shoots so badly from the perimeter. There is Staten coming forward. So Seth, finally an offensive play for the Mountaineers.
I'm surprised those traps didn't come. Not the relentless pressure we saw early in the game.
Over the top to Ellis, knocked away, he runs it down. There's Traylor, open look, missed it.
Kansas has just totally taken any dribble penetration away from West Virginia. When Staten gets the ball, you're gonna see three and four guys in lanes. They're forcing him to kick that ball out because of the game of the Mountaineers. Staten knocked down that jumper right there, but someone's got to step up and make a shot of it. They're going to continue to shrink the court and take the ball out of Staten's hands.
49-47 after that Staten field goal with 9.5 minutes remaining.
Gary Brown.
You know, Brent, to Seth's point, West Virginia can't win this game without Juwan Staten attacking the paint. They may not make shots, but Staten is a catalyst for them.
Well, he's got 18 points tonight.
Yeah, exactly.
Sullivan over the top, forced that three a little bit. Back they come now. Staten wanted it, but Brown kept it.
Staten's gonna rest right here unless they come right back to him, and they do.
Gonna give it to him. Mason's chasing him. He's their offense right now. Trying to break Mason down. Switch by Ellis.
Gotta go.
Here's five on the shot. Miles attacks. Put back is good by Holt. Tied at 49. The 6'7 junior from Miami. Self's turned. Ball timeout. Terrific crowd here in Morgantown. As Fran mentioned in the first half, held down a little bit because of the nasty weather which hit here this afternoon. So when you talk about student bodies, obviously the Jayhawks have one of the great ones, but they're pretty good here, Fran.
No question. They know what's at stake. Their team needs them. West Virginia's lost 3 out of 4 in a very tough conference. I love the idea that, to Seth's point, they're not a great shooting team. They've got to use the dribble and get to the basket.
Let's go to Holly Rowe for an update. Holly?
Well, guys, this pressure is having an effect on West Virginia right now. Carter is on the ground being stretched out, and Juwan Staten is face down right now on the floor, getting his left calf rolled out by a roller. He is cramping. This is huge for West Virginia right now, tied up at 49 without two of their top players.
Yeah, exactly. With Staten out, Holly, that had to go deep into their bench again. They haven't had a lot of production from that group here so far. Green on the floor for the Jayhawks. He feeds Traylor off the dribble. And it goes against the Jayhawks and Traylor. Offensive foul called on number 31. There is to follow up on Holly's story here, Fran, there is the cramping Mountaineer.
Yep. You see Juwan Staten, he's had that effective night. That time, Traylor went one, two dribble too many into the paint.
Carter is back up behind the bench trying to stay loose.
Phillips a driver, Brown more of a driver.
Here's Phillip trying to get inside and he's cut off. Now they give it to Brown. Brown does get in. Mountaineers with an offensive rebound, second chance, Miles. Green stayed right with him that time.
Good move by the freshman. Get it back to Brown, the senior.
Searching for the lead. Brown comes inside, Ellis, tap back, no, and a foul is called as Holton went for the rebound. Ellis picks up the personal, battling for the rebound. So Staten is up and rejoins the huddle here at the 7:20 mark. We'll keep an eye on that story when we come back. We're tied at 49 with 7:20 to go, and they really need Staten back on the floor, Brent.
Oh, they sure do, Brent. Preseason player of the year in the Big 12. Hadn't had the offensive weaponry around him this year because of the defense, but he certainly has stepped up big tonight. Clutch shots, and his ability to get into the paint has really bothered Kansas down a stretch, and it's the way they should play. Seth, they've gotten away from that motion offense and gone more to something else. What do they got?
Yeah, the motion offense is more of an equal opportunity offense. We're looking to reverse the ball, get some curls, but what they've done is they've gone to their spread ball screen stuff, which is kind of a sprint-out ball screen off the lane, and it gives Staten a chance to get a seam, get downhill, and then the other thing it does, he can score it, he can kick it, but it also gives West Virginia a chance to get to the offensive glass.
Holton knocks down the free throw, which puts West Virginia ahead 50-49. They are 4 of 7 shooting free throws here tonight. This is the second one. And the Mountaineers are standing with touch by a Jayhawk player. But the officials will know.
Now, the Mountaineers only have 3 team fouls, so they can be ultra aggressive right now in their pressure.
Knocked away just like that by Phillip.
Yep. Now, this will be a spot throw in because it was deflected out of bounds, so Green can't move.
Mason brings it up on Phillip. Remember, no Staten on that floor right now. And gets into the lane, gets his own miss. And Oubre gives it back to him. They got Ellis down, working on Holton. Good move inside. There was too much daylight, and Ellis went to work.
Great thing about Perry Ellis, he can turn over either shoulder. He's got a lot of weapons in the low post.
Williams off the dribble, and it is Holton underneath with a putback.
You know, he's been quietly effective tonight, Brent. His 9th rebound, 6 points, really good energy, and he stayed on the floor without fouling.
Ellis again. As we go seesawing here in Morgantown with 6:10 remaining. And Huggins wants to talk about it. He's going to get his guards back on the floor, it looks like. I think both Carter and Staten checked back in as he called timeout. And reminder here, Fran, ESPN's Journey to the Tourney season-long spotlight on games will impact the tournament on Wednesday. North Carolina will take on Duke. Now, the Tar Heels stumbled their last time out. Yeah, with Duke.
They lost 3 out of 4, Brent. They've become very soft in the painted area. and Okafor, they're going to really try to attack North Carolina's defense. Seth has seen both teams. I wonder what his thoughts are on that game Wednesday night.
Well, if I'm North Carolina, I'm going to make Okafor defend every single possession, either on a post-up to Meeks or Bryce Johnson, or put him in ball screens. He's gotten in early foul trouble a couple games. I think that's going to be the key. And the other thing, Fran, you mentioned it earlier, Tyus Jones and Quinn Cook, they have been terrific together. Freeing Cook up off the ball, he's having an outstanding senior season.
5:58 remaining. We have a one-point basketball game. And Staten handling the ball after he returned.
Look at all those blue jerseys inside the arc.
Another miss from the perimeter by the Mountaineers.
That's analytically a low percentage shot right there. The long two by Gary Brown. Better off shooting a three there.
Traylor and Lucas both on the floor right now. This is Traylor handling. He attacks. As the pickers dribble up and kick it back outside to Green. Green, a great shooter. Staten knows it. Staten's all over. Gets a screen from Traylor. Gives it to Mason. Now five on the shot. Mason pulls up the three. Rattles and an offensive rebound by Lucas Butt. Devin Williams is down.
He's holding the right wrist, which he injured early in the year. He had tape on it on Saturday. No tape tonight. See him trying to shake it off.
See what he does with this hand as he goes down. Did he brace himself and re-injure it? That could be the case.
I think he did. He was heavily taped on Saturday up in Ames, and he actually injured it then. He's going to come out right now.
And with his fourth personal foul at the five-minute mark. Mason with a fresh 35. Doesn't take too long to score, and the Jayhawks are up by three now inside of 5 minutes, and here we go. From the corner, Carter. Offensive rebound by Williams, and there is the foul. Traylor was in underneath on it. He picks up the personal. I guess it's number 12, excuse me. It's going to be on Oubre. He was there with Traylor. As Ellis checks back in.
Billy D. Williams is from your neck of the woods, Brent, from Winter Park, Florida, and Central Florida. His high school teammate was Austin Rivers. Went to junior college out in Texas.
And here is the young man. Big free throws, trailing by three.
Oh boy.
Holy moly.
Ellis is back. They love to isolate him late in games when they need a basket.
Lucas, they double him on the catch. Ellis steps outside, and here's Mason.
Watch him at the
Ellis
elbow.
Now, he's wide open, missed it. Battled it underneath. Lucas was closing in, and that's going to be offense. I believe it was Holton who was maneuvering. Yes, it was. Holton picks up the personal foul. Huggins can't believe it. That's his third personal. Five fouls on West Virginia, eight on Kansas here in the second half. Now at the four-minute mark. Every possession important now in a three-point basketball game. And there's a foul. And that's Holton, and that's number four. That's his fourth personal foul at that moment. There was no doubt about that one.
Well, he didn't do his work early.
So Devin Williams injured, and Huggy would love to get him back on the floor. He certainly needs him now. With Holton saddled with four personals. Three 3:58 remaining. The Jayhawks up by three. Now, West Virginia has lost three of their last four games. Oklahoma, Baylor, and Iowa State all beat them. And here, Fran, is what's coming up for this team. And it doesn't get a whole lot easier in this conference.
No, not only for West Virginia, but for the rest of the league. Every team in this league still has three teams left that are ranked in the BPI top 35. West Virginia no different.
Ellison low with a field goal, and that builds a five-point lead here at the 3:43 mark.
Remember what we said about Bill Self isolating Perry Ellis? Exhibit A.
Seth, what is it that Huggins is trying to come up with here offensively to get back in this?
He's going to try to run some type of set like right there. He just tried to run a quick flex cut off the baseline. They've got to get to the line so they can make some free throws and then get into that pressure. They've got to find a way to turn Kansas over. This game's like a prize fight. Both teams going back to their benches. One of the teams now has to counter punch, and right now it has to be West Virginia if they're going to win this game.
Welcome to the Big 12. We see this in almost every game. The heavyweight conference. Brown knocks down the free throw.
Remember that Iowa State-Kansas game, Brent, after 10 minutes? They were body blows, and both teams were physically spent.
Two big free throws he knocked down, making a three again at the 3:28 mark. Here comes that pressure. Ellis quickly into the hands of Selden, Oubre, Mason, Lucas on the floor for Self. Ellis underneath, and he's now on the free throw line. It was not a bad foul as long as you could prevent him from making a field goal.
Agreed. Very, very much. And give Kelly Oubre, the freshman, credit. He felt the pressure, got to the basket, and delivered a nice dump off. Self thinks Perry Ellis may be playing some of the best basketball of his 3 years. Last five games, 15-9.
He's got 19 points tonight, mm-hmm. Brandon. He's perfect at the free throw line. He's hit all four to follow up just on what you said. Final 3 minutes now. Mason taking Staten. Carter will try the three.
Yes! What a huge three! What about Nears?
Guy's got a lot of intestinal fortitude.
Now the pressure.
I would trap Selden.
Immediately.
I would come running
down.
He
had a tough time with that press in the first half. Lucas comes out wide. Give it off now to Mason, who attacks. Loose ball picked up by the Mountaineers. They're looking for the tie or the lead. Carter for the lead. Yes! Back-to-back threes. Tremendous performance by Carter, who was obviously cramping as he hit that second three to give them the lead.
Take a look right now. Good set play, dribble handoff. And then here comes number two. Young man from Proviso East High School. Stars are born on Big Monday. Right now, star in the making.
Our sixth lead change. 2:27. Mountaineers have a point. They're on a 6-0 run with those two threes. Ellis to the backcourt. Mason. Oubre. Lucas stays on the floor for Self. Mason attacks. Yes, and now the Jayhawks regain the lead, our seventh lead change.
No rim protection that time for West Virginia. Too easy.
And a timeout has been called. Huggins wants to set the offense here. Down one, 2 minutes to go. Both teams in the bonus, as you can see. Remind everybody, Rivalry Week presented by Wendy's continues on ESPN Super Tuesday. We've talked about the SEC, unbeaten Kentucky, Tennessee, and then how about the Big Ten game? It's always a big battle when Michigan State takes on Michigan, 7-9 on ESPN on Super Tuesday. And so, Fran, I have to say, you called it before this game started. We started this broadcast by you saying this could be a troublesome night for the Jayhawks.
Well, you know the psychology of how a season works. West Virginia has to play desperate. They're at home, Kansas traveling, bad weather, and they have been in a dogfight. But credit Perry Ellis and Frank Mason, two of the veterans. They've got 37 points between them, Brent, and they're coming up big down the stretch on the road.
Both teams have one timeout left here as we hit the 2:01 mark, so keep that in mind. One timeout apiece. This is Staten.
Watch Carter here.
Staten pulls it up. Miss on the J, battle for the rebound. Jayhawk basketball. Oubre in underneath, and here comes Mason now with a one-point lead in the ball, down to a minute and a half.
Oubre's stuck right now.
Off balance, Mountaineer basketball.
He was a man on an island. They couldn't get it back to Mason.
Devin Williams, who was shaken up earlier, out on the floor. Adrian with a big rebound. Staten with the basketball. 104, trailing by a point. Pulls it up again. No. And a foul is going to be called. Pushing foul underneath on Williams.
That's five, Brent, isn't it?
He has fouled out of the game.
First would be the foul call number five, Devin Williams. That's his fifth.
Watch Perry Ellis. He held his ground. Staten's very good in that high paint area, that long two. He's one that makes it, but see the tussle inside?
You know, a year ago when West Virginia beat Kansas, that young man scored 22 points and pulled down 13 rebounds. He along with Staten, but Harris, who transferred to Michigan State, hit five three balls in that game, and that's the one option that the Mountaineers do not have.
That's right.
Outside threat, so that if Staten penetrates, he can kick back to a three-point shot, or they've got Williams underneath.
It's true, and, but the flip side of that is because they didn't have Harris this year, they've had to play this helter-skelter style, which hurts them on the offensive end at times.
Huge free throws. Lucas on the line for the first time tonight. Missed it. Down one inside of a minute. Here they come again. Staten's missed from the field a couple of times. Here's Adrian out high.
Here comes Carter.
Carter's been the big man with those two threes. Adrian's going to loft a three. No! Into Seldon's hands. And back comes Mason off the dribble now. Being hounded by Staten in the corner.
Wow.
Kicks it back outside, and finally a timeout, I believe, has been called.
I think Bill Self called that from the other side of the court.
And Huggins is upset. Huggins is very upset that it was not called on this far side. See that? He tells you exactly what he's upset about.
And he's saying that Mason cleared with the elbow. You don't see that call in the final 30 seconds of the game, Brent. Take a look. I don't know.
Did he clear with it?
Yeah, I don't think there was enough there. He didn't move the defender.
Here's another look at it.
And the defender doesn't go anywhere. I can see that.
Seconds remaining. I want to remind you, Wednesday night, you don't want to miss that. The ACC, Louisville, Syracuse, and then North Carolina and Duke will be your 9 o'clock game, both coming your way on ESPN.
Seth was mentioning Tyus Jones, the brilliant freshman from Minneapolis. In 6 games against ranked teams, he's averaged 16 a game. He's been brilliant.
Seth Greenberg will take a look behind the bench at the Kentucky-Tennessee game, and then Purdue, Indiana, and so final 30 seconds here, and what's West Virginia going to try to do, Seth?
I'm not sure what West Virginia's going to try to get a stop and then push the ball, but I think what Kansas is going to do is try to put Mason in a high ball screen with Ellis, or get Ellis on that mid post and let him drive it left and spin back over his left shoulder. And that late game situations, Bill Self's as good as anyone in the country. West Virginia, they got to come up with a rebound and contest this shot.
It's in that no man's land for West Virginia as to whether they should foul or not. Because if they don't get the rebound, Kansas will seal this game away.
Ellis takes the inbound pass. Holden with the 4 fouls. He'll take Ellis. Staten will come out on Mason. 12 on the shot. They're going to bring it down inside 10. Mason off the dribble. Here he comes, attacking off the glass. Battle for the rebound. It goes out of bounds. West Virginia basketball. 8.3 seconds remaining.
I would check this if I were the officials, unless they're absolutely sure, because of the new rule, go to the monitor and get it right. Bill Self opened up the post without a ball screen for Frank Mason to drive, but a good contest.
Bill Self is asking him who that ball went off of, if he's sure. So they will indeed go over to the monitor. Take a look, friend.
Hard to see, but it does look right there that Ellis followed through. Take a look. Adrian's going to grab it, and I think that's going to be fairly clear.
Good call. Yep. Ellis had the ball. He pushed it out of bounds, yep, off the other player's hands. It should take him 10 seconds to make that decision.
Now, I think here, Brent, you put the ball in Juwan Staten's hands, and you live and die with his ability to get a shot.
Well, Kansas knows that, too. You know, they're going to attack him.
Yep.
Staten has 18 points, but he has missed some big shots down the stretch.
Right.
Carter has been the go-to guy for those 2 threes.
Now, what I would do here is I wouldn't ball screen, because that brings a second defender into the action. I would do just what Kansas did and open up the floor. Let him drive it. If you can find Carter, great. But I think, Brent, you live and die with your senior, your preseason Big 12 player of the year. Doesn't mean he has to take a bad shot.
Traylor is back on the floor for the Jayhawks. Selden, Oubre, Ellis, and Mason.
Now, look who's in the game. Chase Connor. It's his first appearance. This kid is a 40% three-point shooter. He knocked down 3 straight at Iowa State on Saturday.
So, taking the ball out of bounds is Brown. And they put it in Staten's hands. Clock winding down. Staten attacks! Left hand, yes! Yes! Staten puts him out, and here's long pass, Ellis! Other end layup! Tap! No! No! West Virginia upsets the Jayhawks! They charge the floor! Here they go! Holly Rowe is with the hero, Juwan Staton. Let's go to Holly.
Well, Juwan, tell me about the last play when you got the ball in your hands. What were you doing?
Uggs told me get into the rim. So I got into the rim.
How hard were these last 2 minutes to seal this win?
You know, they was incredibly hard. Kansas is, you know, they always the best team in our league. We knew they wasn't going to give up, but we just had to fight to the end.
What did you think when you saw Kansas come down still with 3 seconds left and a look at the basket?
Get back, try to steal the ball, make a play, and let's celebrate.
What does it mean to you to do this in your senior season right here in your home floor?
It's the reason I came back to school. It means everything. We're ready to get on the road. We're ready to shock the world.
Thank you, Juwan.
Thank you.
Thank you, Holly, and no question, Juwan Staton is tonight's player of the game, brought to you by Phillips 66. 20 points, including the game winner for the young man from Dayton, Ohio. And my partner, Fran Fraschilla, called it. He said, even though he's been missing baskets down the stretch, put the ball in the hands of your best player, and Fran, here he comes.
Hey, this is what he does. He came back to school, he said, to make plays like this. He's hard to keep out of the lane when you open up the floor 94 feet. And Perry Ellis came perilously close to making this shot. It would have been not a happy night in Morgantown. Spin, soft layup, game winner.
So Staton with 20 points and our final score, 62-61. Coming up next is SportsCenter as Fran and I say so long from Morgantown along with Seth Greenberg and Holly Rowe.